Hi again. This time I'm going to go through the process I use for applique. At the beginning of the year, I designed and created a stack of applique patterns, most of which use this same process. As part of that set, I designed a geometric horse pattern from which I created a lovely lap quilt, which was given away to be raffled off to raise funds for ME sufferer Katie Stewart. Back here in 2014, she embarked on a journey to save her own life after doctors said, well, basically she had weeks to live. I'll add a link to Katie's journey on Facebook, so please do take a look if you have a chance to do so. So the draw ended, and one of the people who had entered but didn't win reached out to have me make another one. Here's the end result of that order. Thanks, Liz. I absolutely loved making this one in the multicolour way. So this quilt was shipped out to her niece, Liv, who absolutely loved it. Hi, Liv. And here we are. A few months later, I've been tasked with designing and making one with a panda on it for her little brother, Felix. Hello, Felix. Anyone who sews or crafts knows how busy this time of year is, but I've absolutely loved working on this and seeing it come to life. So this video will focus on the applique part of the process and may serve to help anyone that's purchased the patterns from us over at Supercrafts, as it uses the same method as those. I'll pop a link in the description for the available patterns. I'm completely in love with the Christmas ones at the moment. The first thing we need to do is cut out all the pattern pieces. If you purchased a physical copy of the pattern, I'd suggest making a copy and using that instead of cutting up the actual pattern book, but obviously it's your choice. We do have PDF versions available also, which would be better suited if you're outside the UK, as then you won't have to wait on lengthy delivery times. With the pattern pieces cut out, pile them up in their respective colours and lay them out on fabric. This way you know how much fabric to add fuser web to. I've already gone ahead and worked out how much I need for the white of this one. Place your fabric right side down on your ironing board and add the fuser web paper side up to the top of it. Make sure you place it within the fabric. You don't want it to overhang, or you'll end up with webbing stuck to your ironing board or iron. I'm going to take this to the ironing board along with the other colours and get them all fused in place. Sorted. Now comes the time consuming job of drawing the pieces on the paper side of the fabric. Place each piece pattern side down on the fabric. Remember, paper side. You may find it advantageous to lay out the pieces across your fabric before drawing any of them so that you can figure out the best layout to utilise the least fabric possible. All my patterns require the pattern pieces to be face down unless I say differently in the instructions. If you purchased a kit or pattern from elsewhere, check the orientation they require you use. Draw around the pattern pieces. After each one, write the corresponding number within the piece so that when we cut them out later, they're easily recognisable. Now all the pieces are drawn, go ahead and cut them out. Leave the paper in place. Again, I'll cut here. You really don't need to see me sit and cut 48 pieces of fabric. All cut. Now to figure out where to start constructing this adorable panda. With all the patterns I create, I try to add a note on which piece to begin layout with. And I generally work from the centre out on quilt-sized appliques. If you purchase one of our cushion patterns, you'll get the same advice on which to start with, but they're a little less complicated. Now, I folded the bottom section of this up first, as that's obviously not part of the design, so I needed to fold it out of the way to find the true centre. With your placement guide in hand, fold it in half and half again, then pinch the centre to find the centremost pattern piece. In this case, pattern piece 25 is the centre, so I'll start there. Fold your background fabric in half, then half again. Pinch the centre or press it with a warm iron so it leaves a mark for you to work with, just like we did with the placement guide. Open up the fabric. If you're working on a quilt, I'd suggest using a big ironing board. Mine is literally a piece of wood covered in wadding and fabric. Take the first pattern piece and place it as indicated on the guide sheet. Now build around that, adding as many pieces as you can get away with on the space you have. The more you can lay these out, the more accurate you'll be. Make sure you orient the pieces correctly. It should be obvious, but sometimes doesn't present as an issue until you've already started ironing pieces in place. Once you're happy to continue, peel off the paper from the back. ensuring the fuser web is stuck to the back of the fabric, and again, lay the pieces back down. They won't stay stuck until you add heat from the iron, so this is your opportunity to move them a little if you need to. Now take a warm iron and gradually apply heat to small sections at a time. Don't run your iron over it, you risk lifting corners and edges with the base of the iron. Instead, press down, hold for a few seconds, then lift off and continue. Once you're happy they're sufficiently adhered, now you can run your iron lightly over that section. Move the fabric so you can work on another area and continue doing this until all the pieces are ironed down securely. Jump cut. Last piece going in. And iron down. And I just had to show you this lovely face. How cute! Next, we need to stitch all these down. The adhesive backing is great, but it needs to be sewn in place to stop it lifting away from the background fabric. Don't be tempted to leave it. It will eventually peel off and you'll be mortified. I'm using a few different colour threads for this one, natural, black and green. I'm also using this open foot for this, as it means I can see where I'm stitching. The ones we sell have a little red line through the centre, which is handy when you need to stitch down appliques. When it comes to the stitch you use, you can choose whichever you like, but make sure whatever it is will go over both the background fabric and the applique pieces. A straight stitch will work, but the appliques are more prone to fraying. Not an issue as they look good anyway, but still it's worth looking at the stitches available to you and choosing appropriately. For larger pieces, I tend to stick to the same stitch, which on my machine is numbered 54, I believe. I like to play around with the length and width settings until I'm happy. To do this, take a scrap piece of fabric and add a bit of wadding to the back of it and stitch a few stitches. I wasn't certain about the settings here, so I adjusted them just a little. Much better. They're now small enough to use on the large pieces and the smaller ones. So I completely messed up when I added wadding to the back of the quilt front. I didn't double check the record button being pressed, and of course the one time I don't check, it doesn't record. So as I didn't want the applique stitches to appear on the back of the quilt, I simply laid out the wadding and topped that with the quilt front that has the appliques on there. I pinned the two pieces together until I was confident neither would move. And this is where you join me now. Starting in the middle of the quilt, pattern piece 25, line up the edge of the piece with the centre of the machine foot. If you're not using the applique foot, just ensure you have some way of seeing that the needle is stitching over both the background and the applique piece. And begin sewing. When you come to any corners, stop with your needle still in the down position, pivot the fabric and continue. Remember, if you're using more than one colour thread, to change it when you need to. With the front ready to go, iron your backing fabric. Make sure the final iron is on the wrong side so that your fabric is facing down towards the ironing board. Place your quilt front on top and smooth it out. You can go ahead and remove the pins that were previously holding the fabric and wadding together. Iron and pin through all the layers, being careful not to attach the pins through into your ironing board cover. If you prefer, you can give the backing and the front panel an iron, tape the back to a clean floor and pin it there instead. Unfortunately, we've had a few rainy days here in Derbyshire, and so little Paws are refusing to vacate the premises, so I'm using the ironing board instead. So I'm going to go ahead and pin up the rest of the quilt and then I'll be back. All pinned. Now time to mark up the quilting lines. I'm going to quilt around the outer edge of the panda and run lines of stitching 2 inches apart across the rest of the background. Take a ruler and a heat erasable pen and use the panda's ear to begin. Then mark every 2 inches from that line. If you come across a pin when doing this, just mark either side of the pin. For the stitching on the outermost edge of the panda, or whatever it is you're appliquing, you can mark 1/4 inch away across all edges. I've done a bit here to show you what I mean, but I'll likely just eyeball this part. Now to quilt those marks up. I use a stitch length of 3.5 for this one and a natural thread. I left the applique foot on there because I like that I can see the marks clearly enough to guide the fabric accurately. Starting with the line closest to the centre, work from the inside outwards. Yep, press the wrong button twice. Continue sewing the lines, always working from the inside to the outside to allow for movement in the fabrics. Lots of sewing to get done, so I'll pop off and do the rest and then I'll be back. Now to remove the marks. I absolutely love these pens. Once all the marks are ironed away, the quilt is ready for trimming and binding. I'm not filming the process of binding, as I recently did that on the nine patch video, so there's little point in repeating it for this one. I'll add a link to the video in the description so you can reference it if you need to. And here he is. Let's hope he's as much of a hit with Felix as he is with me. Big thanks to Liz for having faith that I could pull this one off. And now a question for my viewers. As sewers and crafters, starting makes in July to get them ready for Christmas, do you get frustrated and bored of Christmas before everyone else starts, or does it get you super excited? Thanks for watching, and if you liked the video, please consider liking and subscribing.